Ladies and gentlemen, the Alpha Omega Council, now in its 40th year, is first and foremost an organization dedicated to providing leadership in the Greek-American community. Our 90 current members come from communities all over New England. We associate because we feel a personal obligation to lead and participate in efforts to promote Hellenism, its history and its ideals, and its local embodiments of these ideals in the areas of charity, philanthropy, and education. We promote fellowship among Greek Americans, and we want to help launch the next generation of Greek Americans. These values are the prerequisites of membership. And Alpha Omega is committed to the preservation of organizations and infrastructure built in New England by fellow Hellenes and Philhellenes over the last century. This commitment is in addition to Alpha Omega's annual support of our core charities, the Hellenic Nursing and Rehabilitation Center, the Boston Metropolis Camp, and the Philoxenia House, as well as contributions to the International Christian Orthodox Ministries and the Hellenic College Holy Cross School of Theology. In all, the Council has contributed almost $2 million to charities since inception. Our commitment to these principles are evidenced in several initiatives. In recent years, we were the main sponsor of the National Hellenic Students Conference at Boston University, attended by over 250 students from across the United States. 40 Alpha Omegans attended as mentors to provide guidance to the students in their respective fields. We helped send college students to Greece to instill the love of the classics in Greek culture through our support of the Boston University Philhellenes, whose charter reads, to promote the appreciation of Greek culture and its continuous history from antiquity to the present day. We support the Examined Life online graduate humanities program, which trains high school teachers to incorporate the Greek classics into their curriculum. This year, we sent one teacher from English high school to Greece for on-site experience. We also sponsor special lectures and receptions geared for high school teachers, laying the seeds for the appreciation of Hellenism. Alpha Omega is working to shape the Philhellenes of tomorrow. Another important activity we steward is the Greek Council General's annual wreath ceremony, now held at the Massachusetts State House. The Greek Consulate presents to the Boston Athletic Association wreaths cut from the trees on the plains of Marathon, Greece, that crown the winners of the Boston Marathon. This event is attended by over 300 members of the Boston Athletic, educational, diplomatic, and other communities. Alpha Omega was an integral part in making this gift possible in 1984. Today, this ceremony has become an exciting platform for us to educate young people on the connection between the Battle of Marathon, the preservation of Athenian democracy, our own American democracy, and the history of the Boston Marathon. And as part of this event, an educational component was developed. This year, over 600 students from Hopkinton and Roxbury Middle Schools wrote essays on the role of the Battle of Marathon in preserving democracy and various aspects of ancient Greek history. 10 of these essays were chosen for special recognition at the ceremony. And currently, we are contributing to the creation of a beautiful new athletic field at the Metropolis Camp in New Hampshire, where over 700 Greek American youth enthusiastically participate in programs every summer. Alpha Omega remains committed to this effort with its grant of $100,000, which was reaffirmed to His Eminence just last week. So I hope this has given you a view into the work that Alpha Omega does. I urge you to support Hellenism and join with us, however you can, as a supporter, with your time, talent, or contributions, or just by spreading the word about what we do. We are looking for new and better ways to serve our community, and we hope you will partner with us. Thank you. I would like to take a moment to thank our co-chairmen tonight, Bill Galatis and Nick Ypsilantis, their committee and friends of this event, for the months of hard work and support to bring us this wonderful program. I especially want to thank Bill Galatis, for his leadership and direction of the committee and the extraordinary effort he made to bring us this event. Thank you all. I also want to recognize a few sponsors for tonight. Our cocktail reception sponsor was John and Sonia Lingus Foundation. Our tribute sponsor was the Barakas Foundation, and our gift sponsor was the Agris family. Thank you all very much. And before I call Mike back to the podium to introduce our scholarship recipients, I would like to take a moment to remember Ann Agris, who recently passed. Ann was the wife of Peter Agris, founder and charter member of the council, and publisher and editor of the Helena Chronicle. They worked together at the paper as an important voice of the Helena community until Peter's untimely passing. Ann worked together with other Alpha Macons to create the scholarship program in his memory. She served as the director of the program with her daughter, Nancy, always accommodating, always with a smile, and was generous with her time, talent, and contributions, not only to the scholarship program, but to the organization as a whole. We will miss her. I would now like to ask Mike Nikitas to come up and acknowledge our scholarship recipients.
Who knows what can happen when I come up here? I'd like to briefly acknowledge the six Peter Agris Memorial Scholarship recipients for 2015 who have joined us tonight. They have already received their scholarships in a separate ceremony, $5,000 apiece, very generous. And they're all studying journalism, some of them going to graduate school. I met, I think, all of them. So as an adjunct professor of journalism myself, it gives me great pleasure to acknowledge them, and I'd ask each one of them to please stand up briefly and be acknowledged. Christina Bogus, Teresa Kotsarilos, Peter Eliopoulos, Zoe Matthews, John Petrolius, and Elissa Vobaril. Would you all please give them a round of applause? Now, I'd like to welcome once again Dan Clark and his wife Mary, who will perform a medley of patriotic songs, and they will represent as part of this each branch of the American military, and they will be assisted, and you'll see how, by the ROTC at Lynn English High School.
You know, ladies and gentlemen, one of the most beloved of all patriotic songs comes right from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. And the story's fantastic about a young lady. A young lady was one of the first literary professors at Wellesley College. Now, she traveled this great country while in sabbatical, and she made it all the way out to the Rocky Mountains, to Pikes Peak. And she stood atop those mountains and looked back over this nation, and she was so moved by her grandeur, she wrote a poem. Now, that poem was put to music so beloved, many people believe it should be our national anthem. Now, if you go down to Falmouth, Massachusetts on Cape Cod, right in front of the public library, there's a beautiful statue in this young lady's honor. Her name is Catherine Lee Bates, and she is responsible for writing the one and only America the Beautiful.
Spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountain majesty. America
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, my bride, the real talent in the family, Mary Colarusso, graduate of the Boston Conservatory of Music. I would not be up here today if it weren't for a great icon of your Greek community. Many people know me as the singing trooper, and a lot of people say, Dan, did you just come up with that name and wake up one day, call yourself this? No, it didn't happen like that. When I was on the state police, I sang many national anthems, about 4,000, and I also performed at funerals. The people who used to sit in the front pew were two people. The governor of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, you may know him as Michael Dukakis, and his lovely bride, Kitty. And after I was done singing, they wrote me a letter how much they thought my performance was great for not only the families, but the departments of the lost ones. Now, I ran into the Dukakis at a Pops concert. I was not in uniform. I just wanted to thank the governor and go up to him and say, Governor, I want to thank you very much. My name is Danny. Kitty! It's the singing trooper. We have to introduce him to Harry. Unbeknownst to me, Kitty Dukakis' father, icon of the Pops community. One thing led to another, and Governor Dukakis, your great friend, introduced me to the Boston Pops, and as they say, the rest is history. So I thank you very much, and Admiral, it is a great honor to be here for you this evening. Now, ladies and gentlemen, obviously as United States Marine, I take the greatest pride in my service and my hymn, and you know it, from the halls of Montezuma to the shores of Tripoli. But I have the greatest respect for all of those who have served. Say, if you serve in the United States Army, you may know your hymn to be Caissons Go Rolling Along. They changed the words just a little bit. It's now called Army First to Fight. The tune Caissons, still the same. If you serve in the iconic United States Navy, your hymn has always been Anchors Away. If you serve in the United States Air Force or Army Air Corps, before you became your own branch of service, your hymn has always been Wild Blue Yonder. Now, in addition, there's a group of men and women who not only guard our shores, but they're deployed to combat venues all over the world. Their hymn, Semper Paratus, always ready. The United States Coast Guard. Semper Paratus, a great Latin term, and you know, the Commodore said, you know, those crazy United States Marines, they have another cool Latin saying, Semper Fidelis. I want one too. So he created Semper Paratus. And finally, there's a group of men and women who were long forgotten until an act of Congress in 1988 ordered that they will also be recognized as veterans, the men and women of the United States Merchant Marines. They like to be called merchant mariners, for you see, they used to take our boys overseas, supplies, boots, bullets, bandages, and many times they were sunk by enemy submarines. Well, they have a hymn they're very proud of also. It's called Heave Ho, My Lads, Heave Ho. Now, I would respectfully request, when I sing your hymn, if you have served, if you've had a family member who has served, if you've been married to a serviceman or woman, do me this favor. You don't have to stand up if you don't want to, but please raise your hand so I can properly recognize you. Now, as I perform these service hymns, the young men and women representing the Junior ROTC Marine Corps out of Lynn English High School will present the colors to each of the branches. Once again, it'll be Merchant Marines, Coast Guard, Army, Navy, Air Force, and then the United States Marine Corps. Please, when I sing your hymn, raise your hand high. Here we go.
Heave ho, my lads, heave ho. It's a long, long way to go. It's a long, long pull with the hatches full. Braving the wind, braving the sea, fighting a treacherous foe. Heave ho, my lads, heave ho. Though the seas blow high and low, we can cross any ocean, sail any river. Give us those goods and we'll deliver down the submarines. We're the men of the Merchant Marines.
Do I have any Coast Guardsmen? Where's my Coast Guard? Come on.
We're always ready for the call. We place our trust in thee. Through howling gale and shot and shell, to win a victory. always on kites. A pledge and motto true, we're always ready, do or die. My Coast Guard, we fight for you, Army. First to fight for the right and to build a nation's might, and the Army goes rolling along. Proud of all we have done, fight until the battle's won, and the Army goes rolling along. For it's high, high, hey, the Army's on its way. Call off your cannons, hard and strong, to hey! For wherever we go, you will always know that the Army goes rolling along. Anchors away, my boys, anchors away. My Marines, on your feet. From the halls of Montezuma to the shores of Tripoli, oh, we will fight our country's battles in the air, on land, and the sea. Hope us to fight for right and freedom, and to keep our honor clean. Oh, we are proud to claim the title.
Thank you to Dan and to Mary and to the Lynn English Junior ROTC. That was fantastic. Now, it gives me great pleasure to welcome the Honorable Iphigenia Kanara, Consul General of Greece in Boston.
Good evening. Your Eminence, esteemed Mr. President, Honorable Admiral Stavridis. It gives me a great pleasure, and it's indeed an honor for me to be here today to pay tribute to a distinguished friend and member of the Greek-American community, Admiral James Stavridis, a man whose reputation as a leader, as a commander, as a scholar precede him, and whose achievements have helped alleviate human suffering and global instability. Back in 2009, when the Admiral took over command of the Allied forces of NATO in Brussels, Europe and actually the whole world was faced with complex challenges and, you know, unprecedented threats. Economic disarray and rising threats to our collective security. And also an atmosphere of crippling political tension loomed over both sides of the Atlantic. Faced with growing threats in the southern Mediterranean and a quickly deteriorating periphery, NATO was in desperate need of Admiral Stavridis' leadership. And however, it was not a forceful, you know, military style which made Admiral's leadership role so instrumental. In fact, although Dean Stavridis may be the accidental admiral, as you all see on your table, his leadership proved that he was also destined for diplomacy. Whether in Athens, Ankara, Brussels, or Washington, Admiral Stavridis has built partnership through consultation, respect, and a commitment to integrity. He understood the nuances of building consensus and has forged friendships that continue to last till today. And as a representative of the Greek government, I'm honored to say that Admiral Stavridis is a real friend of the Hellenic Republic. Above all, the Admiral understands that the apparent incoordination which now confronts the Western world is temporary, and that we must all remember that the fundamental foundations of the Atlantic Alliance is cemented in far more permanent principles, the one of freedom and the rule of law. Recasting the preconceived notions of a rigid military command, Admiral Stavridis' leadership created a dynamic which embodied the wisdoms found in the words of one of his predecessors, President Eisenhower, who said once, "Together, we must learn how to compose differences, not with arms, but with intellect and decent purpose. Thank you. Admiral, you have showed us that despite the arms at your command, the greater weapon truly is the power of intellect and the commitment to a noble cause. We thank you very much and we deeply congratulate you.
Now, our honoree loves music, as we all do. So I'd like to welcome back the Orpheus Band to play three of the Admiral's favorites.
Admiral, one of your favorite writers is Nikos Kazantzakis, who wrote the novel Zorba the Greek. Many years ago, your pals in school gave you the nickname Zorba. So we thought we would play for you that iconic song written by Mikis Theodorakis, known globally as Zorba's Dance. Thank you. in honor of your paternal grandparents who were from Pondos, we'd like to play two Pondiaca songs.
Όταν γεράει μάνα και άλλο και μπορεί. Όταν γεράει μάνα και άλλο και μπορεί. Α, τότε θέλ βοήθεια, α, τότε θέλ ζωή. Α, τότε θέλ ζωή. Και όταν έρθει η ώρα και άλλο και μπορεί. Άμα και φτάσει το χρέος και ύψεις, θα καίγεται ύψεις. Η μάνα εν κρύο νερό και σοβωτήρ και πέν. Η μάνα να μείνεται, η μάνα να μείεν. Η μάνα να μείεν. Η μάνα εν κρύο νερό και σοβωτήρ και πέν. Η μάνα να μείνεται, η μάνα να μείεν. Η μάνα να μείεν. Ήμανα εν φράκος, ήμανα έρασι. Ήμανα εν φράκος, ήμανα έρασι. Στο δύσκολο την ώρα, λες μανίτσα, μανίτσα, μανίτσα να τσαείς. Ήμανα εν το στήριγμα της χαράς το κλαδί. Τα την εσύ αγάπη και βρίσκεται η γη. Και βρίσκεται η γη. Η μάνα εν κρύο νερό και σοποτήρ και πέν. Η μάνα να μείνεται, η μάνα να μείεν. Η μάνα να μείεν. Η μάνα εν κρύο νερό και σοποτήρ και πέν. Η μάνα να μείνεται, η μάνα να μείεν. Η μάνα να μείεν.
Έλα και το κότσαρι! Χάπα! Άιντε! Whoop! How about some hand clapping?
Μωρέ κότς κότς κοτσάρι, κοτσάρι το λέγανε. Αχ, κοτσάρι το λέγανε κι όλοι το χορεύανε. Κοτσάρι το λέγανε κι όλοι το χορεύανε.
Έλα! Hop!
Άιντε! Κοτσάρι, κοτσάρι καλός χορός. Κοτσάρι το λέγανε κι όλοι το χορεύανε. Κοτσάρι το λέγανε κι όλοι το χορεύανε. Χορε κοτς κοτς κοτσάρι, να χορέψεις δεν μπορείς. Α, κοτσάρι το λέγανε κι όλοι το χορεύανε. Κοτσάρι το λέγανε κι όλοι το χορεύαμε.
Έλα, δώσε!
Κοτς κοτς κοτσάρι, κοτσάρι το λέγανε. Κοτς κοτς κοτσάρι, κοτσάρι το λέγανε. Κοτσάρι το λέγανε κι όλοι το χορεύανε. Κοτσάρι το λέγανε κι όλοι το χορεύανε.
σας.
Up here. All right, you remember our two young women who sang the Greek national anthem earlier? They're back. They're in the bathroom learning another song. And I understand it is one of the Admiral's favorites. It's not Greek. And so let me welcome once again Angeli Sumas and Eliza Sanakis.
Thank you for your patience again. This was a change of pace, but we would love if you would join in with us if you are so inclined. angel. John at the bar is a friend of mine. He gets me my drinks for free. And he's quick with a joke or to light up your smoke. But there's some place that he'd rather be. He says, Jim, I believe this is killing me. As a smile ran away from his face. Practicing politics as the businessman slowly gets stoned. Yes, they're sharing a drink they call loneliness, but it's better than drinking alone. Crowd for a Saturday, and the manager gives me a smile, 'cause he knows that it's me they've been coming to see, to forget about life for a while. And the piano sounds like a carnival, and the microphone smells like a beer. And they sit at the bar and put bread in my jar and say, man, what are you? Tonight.
Well worth the wait once again. The Greek Orthodox Church in New England is fortunate to have the long, consistent, and skillful spiritual leadership of our next speaker, His Eminence, Metropolitan Methodios of Boston.
You know, it's always a pleasure coming to this dinner, year after year, looking out upon an audience that is comprised of dedicated men and women that do so much, not only for the Greek Orthodox community, but for the greater American community. It's always a pleasure to share fellowship with people who love God and who love America and Greece. I come to thank you for your many contributions, most especially what you do for young people, how you mentor young people to become future leaders. I especially want to thank you for the Agris scholarships. We remember tonight two beautiful people, Peter and Ann Agris, and we thank Nancy for continuing that beautiful legacy of achievement. And tonight we're here to celebrate the achievements of a man that has honored his country, a man that has honored his legacy, a man that has honored his family and his heritage. It was a pleasure sharing some thoughts at the reception and at the dinner table with Admiral Stavridi and his lovely wife. If you really want to look into a man's heart and soul, you have to listen to what he says. And if you look at page 9, I'm going to read three quotes of the Admiral, which I think reflect what a strong character he is and what a beautiful person he is. No one of us is as smart as all of us thinking together. We are excellent at launching Tomahawk missiles. We need to get better at launching ideas. We seem to have lost our capacity for politeness and for genuine concern about the quality of our interactions in this hectic century. Thank God for people like Admiral Stavridi. Tomorrow we celebrate the Feast of Pentecost, and I pray that the Holy Spirit shine in your heart and guide your steps in the future. God bless you.
Thank you, Eminence. Now, in the news business, as in the military, and I think the Alpha Omega Council as well, we like to think we're good at keeping secrets, protecting our sources, never revealing our sources. Well, tonight we think we have kept our next guest a secret, at least until now. She is here to introduce our honoree tonight. And Admiral, we thought we'd ask your wife, Laura, to say a few words about you before you receive your award tonight. Laura?
I think this is going to be sort of a hard act to follow after all that fabulous music, and especially our JROTC. Let's give them a hand. Good evening, everyone, and let me begin by really thanking the Alpha Omega Council. You've been so kind to think of honoring Jim, and it's a real privilege for me to introduce him. I met Jim for the first time, believe it or not, in 1962. I was just 3 years old, and Jim was the older man in my life. He was 8. some people over the years have told us they were childhood sweethearts, but I have yet to meet anyone with more history than Jim and I really have. What I remember about him from those days was that he was always reading. Every time our families would get together, his younger sister and I would play and run around like little girls do, but Jim would take out his book and read. I also remember that he loved to play tennis and took lessons at the American Club and at the Hilton Hotel in Athens. This was in the early 60s, which is still there today, and it looks about the same. Our families were very close in those days because both of our fathers were young officers in the U.S. military, mine in the Navy and Jim's dad in the Marine Corps. We took vacations together, went to dinners and barbecues together, and often watched movies at home as a group. We were together in Greece for a very full 3 years, and when the families both transferred back to the U.S., they kept in touch throughout the years. We would occasionally meet for a Thanksgiving dinner or a weekend together somewhere, but by this time we had each had our own lives at this point. Jim was headed to Annapolis, and I was starting high school back in Europe, actually, where my father was assigned at NATO, just coincidentally, nothing to do really with what Jim did later. It was just kind of a coincidence. It seemed we would sort of head in different directions at this point. But a few years later, when I was a junior at Dickinson College in Carlisle, Pennsylvania, and Jim was a junior officer en route to an assignment as an engineer on an aircraft carrier, we reconnected by chance, actually in Newport, Rhode Island, very close to here. We bumped into each other by accident in church, had a long kind of brunch together at the Black Pearl Restaurant, if anybody's familiar with that, and discovered, as young people in their 20s do, that we were quite interested in each other. With both of our parents encouraging us, because as I just said, they were longtime friends, we connected later that year in Europe, where Jim's aircraft carrier was deployed, and I was actually doing my junior year abroad in Geneva, Switzerland. One weekend, Jim's ship pulled into Naples, Italy, and he sent me a telegram. Of course, this was a long time ago, so it was telegrams in those days, to meet him at dawn at the Tower of Pisa in Italy, sort of a halfway point between Switzerland and southern Italy. I took an all-night train, showed up, and really hoped he would be there after all that when I was alone. He was there, and it was really the beginning of a 35-year love affair, including 34 years of marriage and two daughters, two wonderful daughters. Our lives together have been kind of a whirlwind of travel with a backdrop of war and peace. When we started out together after being married in 1981, it was the height of the Cold War, and Jim was often deployed for 6 months or longer, many, many deployments. We went through Desert Storm together while he was second in command of a cruiser and in the middle of the combat operations. After the Cold War ended, the focus shifted to the war in the Balkans, where Jim's first destroyer command was the Barry, the USS Barry, played a key role. Then came counterterrorism operations. Jim launched Tomahawks at bin Laden, actually in Pakistan, long before 9/11. By the time September 11th, 2001 came around, Jim was a one-star admiral at the Pentagon, and his office was actually at the center of the side of the building that was hit, on the fourth floor outer ring. He was really lucky to survive that terrible day, and I will always remember him finally coming home. He had to walk back pretty much all the way back from the Pentagon to our home, which was about 15 miles outside of D.C. He actually still had the smell of smoke on him in his uniform, and he had just made admiral, so I remember actually in the days after him trying to kind of save the rest of his uniform and cutting off the gold stripes off of his uniform just because the rest of it was ruined, but we wanted to kind of save at least what he had just put on as a one star. For the next decade, he rose through the ranks as an admiral, including command of the Enterprise Carrier Strike Group, which conducted combat operations in Afghanistan, Iraq, and the Horn of Africa. He also held an important and demanding job as Secretary of Defense Don Rumsfeld's senior military assistant, a period of time when I seldom saw him, since they traveled constantly visiting troops all around the world in the combat zones. He finally became a four-star admiral in 2006, and our final two assignments in the military were both challenging and rewarding, one as commander of U.S. Southern Command, headquartered in Miami, and all military operations south of the U.S., and the other was as the Supreme Allied Commander of NATO, where we lived in Brussels in a beautiful chateau, actually. It was kind of a good time. It's been quite a voyage, actually, with him. Throughout all of our years together, when I think of Jim, actually three things come to mind beyond his career in the Navy. The first is reading. I've never met anyone who reads as much as he does and remembers everything he reads. He can pull quotes out that apply to everyday situations from books he read decades ago. He reads and rereads. Sometimes I get a little jealous of his books, I must say. We have about 5,000 in the house and in storage. But I know at the end of the day, he would gladly give away all of his books if I asked him to. At least I think he would. I'm not so sure. And part of that is writing. When he isn't reading, he is always writing something. He's written 6 books and too many articles to count. He believes, really believes, in the power of words and ideas to shape the world, and has always tried to use them to create really positive outcomes. I think this is a very Greek quality and something I know he inherited from his father. The second thing is a love of people, I believe, and an endless fascination with all different types of personalities in the world. He can see the humor and the good in almost anybody, and he loves to have a fabulous meal, which he often will love to cook himself, like his grandfather, who was a great cook as a new American here in the United States, a Greek restaurant owner. But Jim is a wonderful chef, and I really enjoy that. I enjoy the glass of wine while he cooks for me. He'll pour great wine, spend an evening talking and learning the stories of other people. He always asks people about themselves, about their lives, their families, what they like to do, and I do admire that greatly. Like the great American humorist Will Rogers, Jim never met a person he didn't like, and that exuberance and friendliness shines throughout everything he does. Again, I think this is actually a very Greek quality, and it's part of why people instantly feel at home when they go to Greece. I know I do. Greeks are curious about the world and the people in it, and will spend a great deal of time in the company of friends. Third and finally, Jim is an optimist. While he was very aware of all the dark things in the world, after a lifetime in the military, he's seen a lot of hard things. But he believes that the world is slowly improving and that people more often than not will do the right thing and that we can shape even events in positive ways. He rebounds from challenges and failures, and he has had his share of both, as we all have, I'm sure. His optimism is what has made him so resilient, and he has sustained him throughout the many years at sea and in combat. I'd say he is an optimist, but a realist as well. And I know, given all the challenges in Greece today, those qualities are things that Greece needs as well. Above all, Jim loves his family, and I know that. Our two beautiful daughters, Christina and Julia. We have two wonderful sons-in-law, both doctors. And we have a fabulous Basset Hound that we love at home. No one has ever been a better husband, partner, father, or a better friend. I love him, and I hope all of you do as well. God bless all of you, your beautiful families, the United States of America, and Greece. Thank you so much.
That was so nicely done, Laura. Thank you for giving us a better picture of your husband. It was beautiful. Admiral, your journey through life, which we heard so much about, has literally spanned the globe, and you have inspired thousands of young men and women. We have a short video to illustrate this. So, ladies and gentlemen, please take a look. That was fantastic, and thanks to Bill Galatas for helping to put that together. Ladies and gentlemen, Admiral Stavridis will now be presented with the Alpha Omega Lifetime Achievement Award by the Council President, John Anton.
Admiral, in honor of your long and distinguished service to our country, its institutions, and communities throughout the world, it is our privilege to present you with the 2015 Alpha Omega Lifetime Achievement Award.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Too kind. Thank you. Please. Caristo. Kalispera. Tiganis. Kala, kala. I've now exhausted my supply of Greek. First of all, John, thank you for such an extraordinary personal honor. I deeply, deeply appreciate it. Thanks to the entire Alpha Omega Council for putting this marvelous event together. You deeply honor me, but above all, you honor my wife, Laura, our family, and our Greek heritage. So thank you so much for that. I want to particularly thank my very good friend, Bill, who's put all this together. You've been so kind and become a personal friend in the course of this. Thank you so much. I am struck by the number of connections we've talked about tonight, because this is really what an evening like this is about. This is a room largely full of Greek Americans. There are a scattering of other nationalities and ethnicities represented, from Armenians, my very good friend Aso Tavidian, to the many Irish of Boston, to Italians, my good friend Paulette and her husband Paul, many different groups are represented here tonight. It's about connections. And I think this connection between Greece and the United States is what we should really honor. And in that sense, if I think of all the things that Greece has given to the world, and ultimately to the United States, I would put at the very top of that list the idea of democracy, democracia. It is so fundamental, thank you. It is so fundamental to our lives, to our culture, to our history. We cannot imagine ourselves in a world in which we cannot express our views, express our freedoms, express our rights. All of that was not invented here, nor was it invented in Western Europe. It was invented in a small country on the periphery of civilization called Greece. You can drop a plumb line from the ancient Greeks to the freedoms and the rights and the benefits that we enjoy today. That is the connection that I would argue is the most profound and the most important that we should celebrate tonight. So in honor of that, I'll conclude my very brief remarks of thanks by telling you a story, because that's what Greeks do very well, I think, is tell stories. We drink wine, we tell stories, you know. Tell stories, we drink wine. The story I will tell you is that of another admiral from 2,500 years ago. His name was Themistocles. We have talked a bit tonight about the Battle of Marathon, an important battle. We could talk about the Battle of Thermopylae, another very important battle. I would argue the battle that preserved democracy was the Battle of Salamis, a small bay, a small body of water outside of Athens. You can see it from the harbor of Piraeus. And 2,500 years ago, the Persians were attacking Greece, and they brought a mighty fleet, knowing that at the end of the day, they had to defeat the Athenian fleet if they were going to crush this small country, this democratic land, Greece. Their fleet was 10 times the size of the Greek fleet, 10 times the number of the massive triremes, the great oared ships rowed by oarsmen, 10 times larger than the fleet of Greece. But the crucial difference, the key difference, was that each of the Greek triremes, each of the Greek warships, was rowed by free men, not a slave among them. In the Persian warships, the Persian triremes, all of the rowers were slaves. And the night before the battle, the Athenian admiral Themistocles gathered together the captains of these great warships, and he said to them, "Tomorrow is the battle that will determine the future of Greece. And tomorrow you must tell your men, your free men who will row these ships, tomorrow they must row for their children. Tomorrow they must row for their parents. Tomorrow they must row for their city. And tomorrow they must row for freedom." The next day, the Athenian fleet destroyed the Persian fleet. They preserved democracy, which allows us to walk today in freedom and the light, and allows us the world we know. They rode for freedom. That connection from ancient Greece to our nation today lives in the connections between Greece of today and the United States of America. Long may they prosper. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Dean. At this time, I'd like to ask Commander Sean Kearns from the USS Constitution to come up and present the Admiral with an interesting gift.
So I realize there's been a few remarks tonight, but I'll ask you to indulge me for just a few moments, because like all good Navy men, I have a mission. And as Captain of Constitution, it's my mission to help educate the public about not only USS Constitution, but the Navy and the significance. And getting back to what the Admiral said a moment ago, the connections. And there are rich connections. There probably isn't a symbol or an icon that I can think of that has more connections to people's lives in the history of this country than USS Constitution that is still with us. And there's no exception there with the Greek-American history. Perhaps one of the most well-known and admired crew members of USS Constitution was a gentleman named George Syrian, born in Greece in 1818 on the island of Sara, and orphaned at the age of 6 during the Greek War of Independence. A refugee at sea, rescued by USS Constitution, and fostered until he was old enough to actually enlist, which he did at the age of 10, and served honorably. Well, back then we allowed that sort of thing. He started out as a ship's boy, a powder runner, or as they were known back then, powder monkey, and he rose to be a regular and able-bodied seaman, a gunner, ultimately a master gunner, served honorably for 53 years, at the time the longest active service in the history of the United States Navy. He served, and this is where we get to some more connections, he served as the gunnery instructor at the United States Naval Academy, the Admiral's alma mater. During the Civil War, USS Constitution, which was the training ship for the Naval Academy at the time, evacuated the Naval Academy to Newport, Rhode Island, and with Master Gunner Syrian aboard. We get to more connections when we talk about great Greek Americans like Harry Agganis, and that brings in connections with numbers like the number 33, which was his jersey number when he played for Boston University. 33 is also a great number for Constitution. Constitution, it was involved in 33 engagements and remains undefeated, both decisive naval engagements like with her victory over ships such as the HMS Guerriere, Java, Scion, and Levant, but also capturing merchant ships from various nations over the years of war that the ship served. So we have those two 33s. And Harry Agganis went to my alma mater, Boston University. And here we are with me now as the captain of the Constitution. And we have a couple of 33s here. So from Constitution 33, I present this plaque made from a plank from the gun deck of the USS Constitution and inscribed with the poem written by Oliver Wendell Holmes, which I won't read right now, but it helped save the ship. It truly did years ago. And this plaque is made with timbers taken from USS Constitution, proudly presented to Admiral James G. Stavridis, U.S. Navy retired. And we can't talk about the number 33 in Boston without talking about probably the best known 33, and that's Larry Bird. And we have this autographed picture of Larry, and I believe we have
a
piece of the parquet floor here, and also to present to the Admiral.
Admiral, we have one more gift. Ladies and gentlemen, as you came into the reception area tonight, we asked you to sign the copy of a sketch that was prepared by a local artist, Mark Wakis, in Worcester. So, Admiral, we'd like to present you with the original here tonight, and at a later date, we're going to frame up the one that each and everyone signed here tonight as another memento of your great night tonight as our Lifetime Award winner. Thank you, Dean. Can I have a big round of applause for Mike Nikitas tonight, ladies and gentlemen? Didn't he do a fabulous job? Mike's been in the news business in New England for over 20 years, and Mike, may you have another 20 more. You're an outstanding journalist, and we love you very much. Thank you for being our Master of Ceremonies tonight. Folks, before I ask His Eminence come up to offer the benediction, I just want to spend a moment and acknowledge a couple of people in the crowd. Senator Leo Reptakis from Rhode Island. Senator, over here to my far left. Author and journalist and former Lifetime Award winner, Nicholas Gage. Nicholas. We have with us tonight also someone I just met recently, but really performs a very critical role in New England and the state of Massachusetts, Andy McCauley. Andy? You need to know that Andy is a president and CEO of the New England Shelter for Homeless Vets in downtown Boston. You also need to know that Mr. McCauley was a 30-year U.S. Navy officer who commanded two ships, including the aircraft carrier USS Abraham Lincoln. And finally, they just announced this past week a major expansion for the facility in downtown Boston. Thank you for your good work, sir. Along with Andy tonight, please welcome Commander Leah Reynolds. Leah? Leah just left her role as legal counsel for the Secretary of the Navy and is transferring to the U.S. 5th Fleet in the Arabian Gulf. Good luck. Commander Christopher Nash. Commander, where are you? He's here with his wife, Evangeline Svidoris Nash, and Commander Nash is from the United States Navy, a commanding officer of the USS Wyoming. Commander Nash is joined tonight with his wife, as I mentioned, and thank you very much for making the trip, sir. I'd also like to recognize Sergeant Major Kenneth Oswald, if he's still here tonight. He was the sergeant who brought the ROTC Junior Marines from Lynn English. We're really thrilled that they joined us tonight. So thank you very much, Sergeant Major Kenneth Oswald. Thank you all for being here tonight. It's a special evening. I'm glad that we are honoring the Dean and his lovely wife, Laura. So at this point, I would ask His Eminence to please approach the podium and offer us the benediction. Thank you.
Θεό Θεός ευλόγησον τα περισσεύματα της τραπέζης ταύτης και πλήθρον αυτά εν της οίκης των συνδετημόνων και στον κόσμο σου άπαντα, ότι Άγιος υπάνονται νύν και αίγης αιώνας των αιώνων. Αμήν. Beloved Lord, we thank you for the fellowship we shared this evening. We thank you for nourishing us from the bounty of your riches. We pray that you shine the light of your love into all of our hearts. Make us ambassadors of peace. Make us ambassadors of love and fellowship throughout the world. We especially ask your blessings upon tonight's honoree. Bless the Admiral with many years, filled with your inspiration, your love, and your guidance. We ask this in your name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you, Your Eminence. And I was thinking about you last night as I was watching that terrible hockey game. I really felt bad that your Rangers lost. I wanted them so much to win. But like they tell us every year, maybe next year. Admiral and Laura, welcome to Boston, welcome to the neighborhood, Greek style. Good night, everyone, and please stay around for some dancing and some live music by Affair Spin. Thank you again. Good night.